For 100 years, Grand Home Furnishings has been making a difference. A difference in the lives of the customers who enjoy the fine furniture in their homes.
We want our customers happy.
A difference in the lives of the employees who have found a home in the Grand family.
We are a family, no doubt.
And a difference in the communities who benefit from Grand's generous spirit.
We want them to know that Grand is there.
Reaching the 100th anniversary is a milestone that few retailers reach. So what makes Grand so successful? It all goes back to the hard work and vision of George Cartledge Sr.
My dad ran a grocery store when he was 17. He was the oldest of five children. And it was during the Depression. And the guys that worked in the furniture store all wore ties. And he wore an apron. So he finally got them to give him a chance. And he said, I'll work for you for 6 months for nothing. At the end of 6 months, you can pay me what I'm worth. He was a very good salesman, and they wanted to keep him. So in 1937, they opened a company called Southeast Wholesale Furniture. He was a minority stockholder in that. They bought the store in Roanoke in 1945. In 1950, my dad persuaded them to take his minority interest in the old company and give him the store in Roanoke. And that's sort of the way we started. But the Hash family really started in 1911.
The first store wasn't a furniture store at all. It was a piano store located on the corner of Kirk and First Streets in downtown Roanoke. In the 1920s, the Hash family began to add some furniture.
They also had Victrolas, as you would imagine, and radios was a big deal. I mean, radios were a piece of furniture. When George Cartledge purchased the company in 45, that's the point at which they started saying, you know, we need to kind of get out of some of this music-related merchandise and concentrate more on the pianos and the furniture.
His focus on furniture led him to a businessman named J. Wade Kincaid.
My father had just formed his company in 1946, and he was selling small cedar chests and cedar wardrobes. And Grand Piano, which is what we called them back then, was one of the first customers.
The two men became friends and saw opportunities to help both companies grow. In the early 1950s, Mr. Cartledge asked Mr. Kincaid to make a bedroom suit.
He told Mr. Cartledge that he would be glad to try to make this, but he had to have larger quantities. So Mr. Cartledge, he got on telephone and he called people at Haverty's and Rhodes and people all that he had known through his contacts. And basically he got commitments for 2,000 bedroom suits. That's how we got into the bedroom business.
In 1951, Mr. Cartledge, along with Henry Williamson, began thinking of ways to expand the business into other communities.
We do market research today, but market research then was probably a trailer load of pianos.
So that's what they did. They loaded up a trailer full of pianos and drove it to Radford, Virginia on weekends.
We had a trailer fixed up with steps and carpet in the trailers and curtains on the side of it. We'd sell it, and if we had people with us, a pickup truck, and if they wanted delivered, we'd deliver it right on the spot to them.
That venture was so successful, they tried the same thing in Covington. Until one weekend, the crew arrived to open the makeshift store, but ran into a little trouble with the sheriff.
They dug up some old law that you couldn't have a part-time store, so they wouldn't let us open the store that morning.
In response, Mr. Cartledge opened full-time stores in both Radford and Covington. He also started eyeing other markets. The next store to open was in downtown Lynchburg in 1953, and he wanted to do something special for the grand opening.
They gave away a plastic mirror about that big. It had a calendar on one side and Cokes. And you can see the results in that picture. They had to block Main Street in Lynchburg because so many people came for a free Coke in that little mirror. So my father decided if people want a Coke that badly, we'll give them a Coke every day.
And that started a tradition that is uniquely Grand.
Welcome to Grand. You will always be treated like a welcome guest.
These people are our guests, and it's just a way of welcoming them, and we're very strict about it. I had a man tell me recently, he said, you know, I only came in here to get this Coca-Cola. And I said, guess what? The reason we gave you the Coca-Cola was to get you to come in here, so we're even.
I remember when I first came on the floor that I would have to race George Cartledge Sr. to the Coke machine. I mean, that was part of it. It was a race.
We give out close to 1 million Cokes a year now in our stores.
And, you know, that would be a good cost cutting. But it's a company tradition now, and as long as we can, we're going to continue to give out cakes.
Grand continued expanding in 1957, this time into Charlottesville.
The company bought an operation up there called M.C. Thomas, which was a furniture company that had opened in 1907. And we operated under that name into the mid-80s.
Mr. Cartledge was constantly thinking of new ways to grow his business.
We had started a piano factory with Kincaid Furniture in Morganton, North Carolina, in the late 50s.
My father and Mr. Cartledge derived a plan that we could use my father's furniture making expertise and grand pianos selling and marketing expertise and started a new company. And we did that and called it Grand Piano Manufacturing Company.
That venture lasted until the late 1970s, when it was sold off. In the 60s and 70s, Grand opened many more stores and made several acquisitions, for the first time, outside of Virginia. During this time, Grand cemented its image that sets it apart from other companies. They believe that if you take care of your employees, they will take care of your customers.
The owners of this company just respect their employees. Their statement is, you know, how we want our customers taken care of. And it's really hard to get your employees, if not impossible, to have your employees treat your customers like you want if you treat your employees like dirt.
I've been through a few hard times with illnesses with children, and the Cartledges and the Bennetts stood beside of me. You know, I mean, they cared for me like I was their own. It's always been such a great feeling of family.
That feeling is one of the reasons so many people have stayed with Grand throughout their careers, like Fred Flora, who's celebrating 64 years with the Grand family.
Well, I went to work at Grand Piano, started repairing radios and record players for about a year. Then I took over the warehouse as manager of the warehouse.
Grand is known for promoting within.
George Cartledge Sr. had a way of getting you to do things that you never thought or realized that you could do.
1980 saw the company open a small-scale mall called the Grand Pavilion. It was anchored by a high-end store called Grand Interiors. During the 80s, Grand also tried to help communities with fledgling downtowns, propelling Grand's business model of renovating vacant department stores.
What was nice about that is it breathed new life into some of these downtowns that otherwise had these big, hulking, empty, vacant buildings right in the heart of their downtown. And so it was good for us because we could get a building inexpensively, but we could also help make the downtowns a little bit more viable.
Then came the flood of 85.
We had had all this rain for like a week, and then a hurricane got stalled over Roanoke.
Grand's flagship store downtown, which also housed the corporate offices, and its exchange store two blocks away, started filling with water.
Water just started coming up through the floor. It was just kind of bubbling up through the carpet.
I was petrified. Water was up to my waist in the store when we were rescued. And I think there were about probably 10 or 12 people in the store at that time. But we held hands and walked up to number one fire station. And a lot of people there never got home that night.
I was stuck. Now, I figured I was going to spend the night at the firehouse. George Cartledge Sr. was sitting there right next to me. He said, well, you're coming home with me.
Even as his business was being washed away, George Cartledge Sr. was thinking of his employees first. When it was over, Grand held a flood sale of the furniture they had salvaged.
And people just saw it as an opportunity to buy something that they could clean up and make into something nice.
Then in 1991, the company opened its Valley View location, signaling a permanent switch to mall area stores. A later renovation to this store included a full-size merry-go-round with hand-painted horses.
We had a woman who worked at a competitive store recently who's a friend of one of our salespeople. And she said she thought this family was getting ready to buy this furniture. And all of a sudden this little kid looked up and said,
when are we going to Grand where they got cookies and the merry-go-round? And it just ruined her sale. Those kids that ride our merry-go-round today, 20 years from now, they're probably not going to be shopping somewhere else.
George Cartledge Sr. continued to be involved with his company, even as his health was failing.
He was there every day, even when he, was not feeling well. He would have someone to bring him to the office.
One of the last of a generation of Roanoke Valley power brokers has passed away.
In March of 1997, George Cartledge Sr. died at the age of 87.
I know I miss him dearly. He was a mentor to me, and he was always very nice to the employees.
He was just an incredible man, just incredible. He's meant a lot to a whole lot of people.
Mr. Carter Sr., I knew him well. He was a good and kind person. He was almost like a brother to me. I used to travel with him a lot around to the stores. Some of the salespeople, they said, "That's a beautiful tie you got on." He'd pull it off and give it to them.
We'd hire someone, hire a fella, and if he didn't have a suit or whatever, Mr. Cartledge Sr. would say, "Ziegler, take him over to Millen Roads and get this fella a suit."
The company now runs under the leadership of his son, George Cartledge Jr., and his grandsons, George Cartledge III and Robert G. Bennett. The company also operates under a new name now. In 1995, Grand opened a store in South Carolina under the name Grand Piano and Furniture. Then in 1997, the company opened a second store there and called both stores Grand Home Furnishings.
And George Cartledge Jr. was there for the opening, and at that point in time, we had not handled pianos for several years. And a lady came in the store there during the opening and really gave him what for. She got right up in his face, as a matter of fact, and said, "You don't have a blip piano in this whole store. How do you call yourself Grand Piano?" And he got to thinking about it and said, "Well, maybe it's time to drop the piano, literally."
We did an elaborate commercial, which was kind of cute back then.
We've dropped the piano. Now we're just Grand. Grand Home Furnishings, because we don't sell pianos anymore, just quality home furnishings.
Nobody ever called me and cussed me out for changing the name, which I expected somebody to do.
The community has always supported Grand, and Grand has always given back. Now, for its 100th anniversary, Grand Home Furnishings is taking its generosity to a new level.
George Cartledge Sr. firmly believed that you needed to give back to the community. We had been always so blessed with so many, such customer loyalty, and he felt that, you know, it was our responsibility to give back. And 100 grand gestures is our intent over the course of 2011, is to have each of our stores and warehouses do 2, 3, maybe 4 major efforts in their community.
You know, we can go into a battered women's shelter and refurnish it and remodel it and have, we think, more of an impact than just throwing dollars at a situation.
That's a big deal to me, to make people happy. I mean, that's what we do.
People say, "You guys are so lucky. This must be a really great place to work." Well, in fact, it is. It just is.